Good evening and a warm welcome to Daksha Dialogues. I'm Anand Padmanabhan, Dean at Daksha Fellowship, India's first fellowship for lawyers with specialization in three different pathways: technology law and policy, law and regulation, and disputes resolution. We are grateful to LiveLaw for partnering with us and promoting the course of legal education. It is my pleasure now to introduce our speakers for today, Mr. Gautam Bhatia and Mr. Suhrit Parthasarathy. Gautam is a DPhil candidate at the University of Oxford, where he's reading law. He read for the BCL and the MPhil at Oxford and for an LLM at the Yale Law School. He is the author of Offend, Shock or Disturb, Freedom of Speech under the Indian Constitution, which was published in 2015 by the Oxford University Press, and The Transformative Constitution, which came out last year and was published by HarperCollins India. Gautam practiced for 4 years as a lawyer in New Delhi and was part of the legal teams challenging the constitutionality of Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code, which prohibited same-sex relationships, and of course the Aadhaar project, India's national biometric identification scheme. His work has been cited often by the Supreme Court of India and by various high courts. Suhrit Parthasarathy is an advocate practicing in the Madras High Court. He's a graduate of the National University of Juridical Sciences, Calcutta, and has over 10 years of experience at the bar. He also possesses a graduate degree in journalism from Columbia University, New York. Suhrit's litigation practice is primarily focused on income tax and public law work. He's also a regular contributor to the op-ed pages of the Hindu newspaper, where he writes predominantly on subjects of legal and constitutional significance. He's also published articles in a number of other dailies and magazines, including The Caravan, The Open, Indian Express, The Economic and Political Weekly, and the websites of The New Yorker, The Atlantic, and The New York Times. Today, they'll be in a conversation on the Indian judiciary, its role and responsibilities, primarily focusing on how the Indian Supreme Court has fared in the last few years in terms of standing as a bulwark against legislative and excessive executive action. Before we begin this session, I would like to remind you that all participants in this session are on mute, but you can post your questions and queries in the Q&A tab and we'll take them up at the end of the session. So with that, over to you, Suhrit, to begin this conversation with Gautam. Thank you.
Good evening to all of you. I think Gautam will actually sort of begin by making a few introductory comments and then we'll take the conversation forward from there.
Thanks, Suhrit. I hope everyone's doing well in quarantine and lockdown, as the case may be, and hopefully this time will pass soon. I wanted to begin by, well, first of all, at least establishing a shared starting point that at present there is something of an institutional crisis at the Supreme Court, a crisis of legitimacy, you know, that's been visible over the last 3 or 4 years. It's grown particularly acute in the last few months specifically. And I think that we can all see the points of that crisis and the stress points and all of that. And we don't need to go over that all over again. But I think what's important is to locate the present situation in a longer history and to ask ourselves why and how have we got to where we are? Because I think being able to identify the true nature of the problem will go some way towards devising possible solutions. So I want to just begin with what I think is a bit of a story spanning the last 3 or 4 decades, and then hand over to Suhrit to provide his thoughts on what he thinks of that. And for me, this particular story begins in around 1980, when we had another serious institutional crisis at the Supreme Court. This was the crisis following the political defeat of Indira Gandhi's emergency, and how in the context of that defeat, the Supreme Court's judgment in ADM Jabalpur stood out particularly as a low point in both the emergency and the court's own institutional history. So here was an institution that was facing a serious crisis of legitimacy, serious questions about its role in India's democratic framework. Now, I mean, as you all know, there's a popular narrative that the Supreme Court chose to respond to that crisis by devising public interest litigation and by becoming a Supreme Court of the people, as that's often the term used. Now, I think the more important point is that to do that, to become the Supreme Court of the people and to achieve what it was trying to achieve through PIL, the Supreme Court was faced with a problem. And the problem was that the constitutional text, read in its natural way, did not allow it to do what it wanted to do. And the Constitution's framing history also militated against that kind of an action. And so, according to me, there were two possibilities that were open to the court. One was to fashion a new mode of judicial reasoning, a new way of thinking that remained grounded to the constitutional text, to constitutional structure, but nonetheless took into account, you know, a number of other factors. There were examples of this. For instance, the famous PUDR judgment of 1983 that linked the right against forced labor to a minimum wage is a good example of the court actually using the resources of constitutional text, history, and structure open to it to fashion what you would understand in reductive terms as a socioeconomic rights jurisprudence, as a progressive jurisprudence. So you did have those examples. But by and large, the court chose to go down a different route. And that route was to rely upon the moral force of the outcomes it was championing to make up for the lack of institutional reasoning that led up to that. So if you say that there is a right to food, a right to livelihood, a right to shelter, it's very hard for a person to disagree with you and still sound reasonable, right? And so what the court did, and this is my belief, through the 80s and 90s, was that the rights it was locating in the constitutional text and the rights it was articulating were so basic in ethical terms, in universalist terms, in moral terms, that there could be no question about how the court got there and the methods it chose to arrive at that point. And because those questions could not be asked, similarly, therefore, other questions about how to fashion remedies, how to make these rights actually enforceable, also it made it difficult to ask those questions as well, because it was all subsumed within the moral imperative of giving a voice to voiceless people, of ensuring that justice reached those who were most marginalized. All very noble goals that no one disagrees with. But I think that the damage that did, the lack of effort to find coherent reasoning to back it up, actually brings us to the point where we are now. Because the court was positioning itself as a spokesperson for the people against the callousness of the political class. It was possible to do that while you had coalition governments, you know, ruling at the center, while the court could actually position itself against the political class. It becomes far more difficult to do that when you actually have a strong majoritarian government at the center, elected by a popular mandate not once but twice, because then obviously the court can no longer claim to be speaking for the people against a corrupt political class. And so then suddenly the court's position becomes much more fragile, and its institutional role then comes into question, at which point what is important is to have a legacy of strong legal reasoning, of strong institutional judicial reasoning that is independent of the outcomes that the court wishes to subscribe to. And I think that what's happened over the last 35 to 40 years is that in the context of fundamental rights, that link between the premises and the conclusion and the outcome, that link which is judicial reasoning, strong reasoning, that focuses and takes seriously constitutional text, structure, history, and so on, has been abandoned. And so now effectively what you have are two binaries. Either the court says that, look, the government has failed, there is a vacuum, we are stepping in, and we will manage everything. A classic example of this is the NRC. This is exactly what happened in the last 5 years over the NRC. The court says, you, the government, are failing in your duty to identify undocumented migrants. We, the court, will now administer this, and we will take over everything. We are the ones who will do this. You can stay out of the picture. Either you have that, or you have the situation which you have seen over the last 3 or 4 weeks, where the court says that the three M's the executive has access to effectively gives it the best position to handle the pandemic. No one is denying that. And then you get the leap. The court says that therefore rights, enforcement of rights is not particularly important right now. And so we are going to just like take a hands-off approach. So that there could be a middle path between these two binaries. That there could be a situation where the court is not meant to take over the functions of the executive, but actually is to provide a forum where you can hold the government to account, require it to reveal the reasoning behind its decisions, and adjudicate that reasoning from the perspective of constitutional standards, using legally defined and manageable standards. Could be proportionality, could be anything else. And you know, you can see it happening in other countries, South Africa, the UK. You have established legal standards that deal with situations of this kind, right? That this middle path exists, where it's not either the court taking over or the court abdicating. But that requires a detailed and long-standing level of thinking about what those standards mean, what the court's institutional role is vis-a-vis the executive, what the role of legal reasoning is, what roles it can play. And I think that the absence of that is the absence we are keenly feeling right now. And any move towards resolving the situation requires all of us to rethink from the basics once more about what the Constitution actually guarantees to us, what the court's role is, and what the role of courtroom proceedings or litigation is in making those rights effective. And so with that, I'll hand over to Sourit and you know carry this on.
Thank you, Gautam. I mean, you made a number of important points there, largely in terms of how the court has developed a number of rights, but there are still huge question marks over what its primary institutional role is and ought to be. Now, we've seen over the course of the last 3-4 years that the court has been mired by a number of other problems, which in many ways also tend to influence how it performs that institutional role. I'm speaking specifically about the role of the Chief Justice of India as the master of the roster and who decides which bench hears which cases and other issues concerning recusals, principles of natural justice, etc. Now, time permitting, we could come to some of these later. But what we are broadly looking to cover here is to try and provide a picture of what a court, a constitutional court in a democracy ought to mean and what its primary functions ought to be. Now, as you mentioned, it's important, I think, to sort of go back to first principles. I mean, we have this idea of ubi jus, ibi remedium, right? That is, where there are rights, there are remedies. And we've seen over the development of British common law, that many rights itself have been fashioned out of remedies. If you look at the writ of habeas corpus, for example, it was a bunch of various remedies that were being granted for rights that were taken as sort of inalienable, which ultimately led to the fashioning of the writ of habeas corpus under the common law as a grant of a prerogative writ. Now, broadly, I think in public law, you have two kinds of remedies. One is remedies that have been fashioned out of private law, which is remedies of injunctions and declarations. And other remedies that we are more commonly aware of, which are remedies that are prescribed by the Constitution itself, which is the right to approach the Supreme Court under Article 32 or the High Courts under Article 226, praying for the grant of various different kinds of prerogative writs. Now, if we look at Article 139 of the Constitution, we'll see that Parliament has been granted the power to accord authority to the High Courts or the Supreme Court, or I mean, more specifically to the Supreme Court, to issue writs other than for the enforcement of fundamental rights. Now, this, I think, by itself, by implication, means that the Supreme Court exists, or the power under Article 32 at any rate, exists to enforce fundamental rights and nothing else. And that, as we've seen over the course of the last 30, 40 years, and as you rightly mentioned, over the course of the development of public interest litigation, we've seen a withering of that idea. For example, I'd like to take a couple of examples here, and relatively recent examples. if you look at the case concerning the networking of rivers in 2012 and the judgment that was delivered in that, these were emanated out of writ petitions that were filed, I think, in the early 2000s, and the judgment was ultimately delivered by a three-judge bench in 2012. The prayer made was for a grant of a writ of mandamus to the central government to essentially undertake a program of linking all of India's rivers together. And ultimately, the Supreme Court goes ahead and grants a number of prayers and grants a number of reliefs, which are predicated upon a grant of a mandamus, despite there being no enunciation on what fundamental right has in fact been violated at all. If we look at the judgment and if we read the judgment, we'll see that there's one particular paragraph where the court says that the petitioner has averred that the right to life and personal liberty under Article 21 includes implicitly within it a right to grant of clean water and a right to access water. Now, beyond this averment made by the petitioner, there's no other reasoning that is provided by the court at all. But despite that, it grants a clutch of reliefs and essentially in the nature of a mandamus to the central and the state governments, which essentially is ultimately a usurpation of power and a takeover of what we would commonly consider as legislative or executive functions. The other case from 2016 concerns the ban on the sale of liquor on national highways. Now, these were, I think, delivered through two judgments, one at the end of December 2016 and the other in March 2017. And if we look at the judgments, I mean, there is in this judgment some sort of attempt made at linking the grant of the remedy to a right to life under Article 21. But again, it's not based on a solid principle that the judiciary here is in fact best placed to grant these reliefs. Because ultimately, again, this is the court wading into what are executive or legislative functions. Now, there's some amount of justification that the court grants based on deliberations that have happened within the executive or policies that have been framed by the executive in terms of the central executive in particular, in terms of what it might propose to do to regulate the sale of liquor on highways. But for the court to go ahead and say that there are certain areas on which liquor cannot be sold is, I think, a usurpation of the power. And I think it is really symptomatic of what PILs have come to. But I also think, I mean, there's been a lot of writing done on this, especially Anuj Bhuvania's book, which sort of charts the development of PILs over the course of this 30-40 year period that we looked at. But I think in many ways we might have to look even further back, because I don't think PILs were necessarily born out of that common history that is assigned to it, which is the sort of shame that the courts might have felt due to the role that it played during the emergency. But if we go back, I think we'll see that there are a number of other cases where there were reliefs that were granted in public interest without specifically assigning this tag of it being a public interest litigation. And I think that's where we need to take this principle of standing back to. So I would say that there are a number of core things that the courts should do in order for it to really perform its true role. One is obviously rethink the idea of PILs and rethink the rules of standing. Now, by rethinking PILs, I don't mean doing away with public interest litigation, but start to treat public interest litigation like you would any other form of litigation. You still ask questions about standing. For example, in the UK, you have principles of sufficient standing in terms of trying to establish where a petitioner can in fact approach the court. Now, a sufficient standing rule need not necessarily mean that the petitioner herself has suffered a wrong, but it could mean that the petitioner has sufficient interest in the matter in order to establish standing. Now, we might want to think of a rule of that kind, but I think that the sufficient interest standing should not take away from the idea of PILs in general, because I think there is some amount of textual justification for PILs, because if we look at the text of Articles 32 and 226, it doesn't actually say that only the person affected should approach the court. 32 merely says that the rights guaranteed by Part 3 can be enforced by approaching the Supreme Court. It doesn't say who can approach the Supreme Court. So I think it's important to stop treating PILs as special. It's also important to sort of ensure that PILs are not treated as non-adversarial in nature, which the courts have done over the course of the last 30, 40 years by appointing amicus curiae, for example, and by appointing court commissioners and so forth, continue to apply the same rules that you would apply to any other proceeding to a PIL. And as you said, think about standards of review, get back to solid legal reasoning. But there's one point that I think that the courts need to additionally think about, and I'd like to sort of make this point in terms of some of the judgments that have been delivered more recently. And this is about evidentiary standards in terms of fact finding and standard of proof. Now, we have this common notion that constitutional courts somehow do not decide disputed questions of fact. And I find this exceedingly perplexing. We see it applied by high courts, by the Supreme Court, that, oh, this is a disputed question of fact, we will not touch it. But I think that is really anathema to public law in many ways. It is anathema to public law because almost any dispute that involves a violation of a fundamental right or an assertion that a fundamental right has been violated would necessarily involve an assertion of a fact and would necessarily involve disputed questions of fact. Now, it might not be anathema to public law in Britain, for example, where you have tribunals, etc., decide questions of fact, and then you approach the constitutional courts through the appellate process. But where you see the Supreme Court as a court of first resort under Article 32, or the high courts as a court of first resort under Article 226, it's important that they apply a rigorous standard of evidence in terms of fact-finding and in terms of standard of proof. Now, there is this idea, I mean, for example, in the Aadhaar case, we all know that a PowerPoint presentation effectively served as effectively served as a substitute for an averment made by affidavit. Now, obviously, in writ proceedings, the ordinary course that is followed is filing of affidavits by the petitioner and filing of counter affidavits by the state and rejoinders to that. And all of that is placed in affidavit. But I don't think one should necessarily do away with maybe the idea of a cross-examination where one is demanded. For example, in the Aadhaar case where a PowerPoint presentation was made by the UIDAI, the petitioners ought to have been granted the ability to cross-examine the chairperson of the UIDAI who had made these assertions on through a PowerPoint presentation. It was asked for and it was denied. I think there was a list of 10 questions that were allowed to be posed. I don't think the court can decide really what sort of questions can be asked. I mean, the courts, of course, will have the final say in terms of relevancy of the questions, but I don't think it can go beyond in terms of placing restrictions on the number of questions that can be asked. So I think it's important to devise evidentiary standards, look at fact-finding more seriously, do away with the appointment of an amicus unless you want an amicus to assist you on how a question of law ought to be decided, and ultimately build public trust and confidence in the administration of justice. And the only way to build public trust and confidence is, as you say, by going back to these first principles.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, there's a lot to, like, I think, think about then. I think a good starting point is to distinguish the manner in which the Aadhaar hearing was conducted with the manner in which a very similar hearing was conducted in Kenya a few months ago. In Kenya, the NIIMS, or the Huduma number, which is their kind of equivalent to Aadhaar, National Biometric Identification System, that was challenged in their high court. And this is a constitutional challenge. The challenge was to the constitutionality of the NIIMS, this digital ID. And in Kenya, they have three layers, the High Court, Court of Appeal, and their Apex Court. Now, but this was still a writ. It was a constitutional case. And the way they went about it was that they required technical experts from the government side and technical experts from the petitioner's side to testify about the design of this project and the manner in which it did or did not violate the rights to privacy, equality, non-discrimination, and so on. The arguments, in fact, were very, very similar in both countries because what was happening was quite similar. And in Kenya, actually, a substantial percentage of the actual hearing was spent on the evidence of these experts and intensive cross-examination that went on for days, 3 or 4 days they were cross-examined. And the actual arguments on law took an amount of time that was lesser than the cross-examination. Because what the court, I think, understood there was that if you're challenging something as complex as a national biometric ID system. And honestly, a lot of important PILs revolve around these very complex issues. It could be technical design, it could be other issues, right? You can't understand the true scope of the challenge unless you understand facts. And you can't understand facts without resorting to the law's time and tested way of determining facts, which is through the clash of competing versions subjected to cross-examination. Right? And so I think bringing back the importance of first establishing the factual matrix within which the constitutional challenge is taking place is really important, because the question of rights violations, and specifically in cases where technology intersects with the constitution, requires an understanding of facts. So I think that's one point I'd make. The second point, I think, goes to your two examples, the two cases you mentioned. And I think that what we are seeing over the last few months now has become this kind of constitutionalism of convenience, where when the court wants to avoid interfering, it says this is a question of policy, right? And therefore, we will not intervene. Right? Where the court does want to intervene, it being a question of policy then somehow no longer has any relevance. I mean, just recently when the AGR judgment was there, right? Now, if the government wants to restructure the obligations owed to it by people who owe it money, I would think that is a fundamental question of government policy. So there suddenly all those considerations no longer seem to hold. And I think that to go back to the point, you can't, so this until you first establish what the content of the constitutional right is, right? What exactly does Article 21 encompass? What does it mean when you say there's a right to healthcare? And I'll just come to that in a moment, or a right to food, or a right to shelter, or a right to work. And until you first rigorously clarify the scope of these rights, right, you will be unable to have a principled distinction between matters of policy and questions of rights, because that's where the line is drawn, right? So if it's a question of policy, it means that the government, you know, the court won't interfere to that extent. But at the point at which that policy decision impacts a fundamental right, there and to that extent, the court comes in. And again, to take a recent example, I mean, this very controversial order on free testing for COVID-19, right? I know that the order has been very controversial and people have different views on that. So I don't want to get into the merits of whether the court can order free testing or not, or should have. Let's leave that aside. What I want to say is two things. First is that for the last 30 years, we have been told Article 21, right to health, right? There is a right to health. Now, what that means in the context of a public health crisis, a pandemic, right, where testing is the basis of identifying and containing the pandemic, according to the WHO, right? What does the right to healthcare mean in that context? We don't know, right? We don't know what the answer is, because there's never been serious, rigorous thinking on what the right actually entails. The second thing is that the argument made, right, is that if the court orders free testing, then what will happen is that there'll be a loss that's caused to the government and to these private testing labs. There will be a lesser amount of testing, right? And therefore, overall testing will go down. And therefore, this will be a case of the court with good intentions intervening, but leading to a bad outcome. That's the argument that we've heard. Right? Now, that argument is obviously based on some calculations, right? Some figures on what the costs are, you know, what the expenditures are. Is there actually a causal link between the two or not, right? Now, again, and this is it's really important to really think through what review means here, judicial review means here, because it is nobody's case that the court make its own calculations about, you know, what the economics of it is, right? That nobody's saying that. Nobody's saying the court decides that this is the economics of the pandemic. What the court, however, can do is ask the government, okay, government or okay, private lab, you are saying that this will lead to ultimately the number of tests going down. Show us the calculations that have gotten you to that conclusion. The court will not make its own calculations. It can, however, at least see that there exists some calculation that is at least prima facie rational, right? Because often what you see is that the moment that you actually ask the state to produce the reasoning on the basis of which it claims to take a decision, you'll find that there is no reasoning there because it's a blanket assertion, right? That just does not stand up to any scrutiny. And so if you see the court's role as neither abdicating nor substituting, but as a body that holds the government to account and requires public reason to exist for the government's actions that implicate fundamental rights, then you have a vision for the court's institutional role. But as I said, that would require two things. It first requires you to seriously think about what rights the Constitution guarantees, because until you do that, you can't get further than that, because then you can't distinguish between policy and rights, and then you will have this cynical judicial approach about of holding back where they don't want to and coming in where they do want to. And secondly, you have to think about how these different branches of state, legislature, executive, court, engage in the implementation of these rights, and think about the different layers of what the court can do that are not restricted to taking over or like abdicating.
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to sort of respond to and catch on to a couple of points that you made. One is obviously this idea of policy and principle. I mean, we have this famous Dworkinian distinction between policy and principle, but as we know, I think there can and often is plenty of overlap between policy and principle. And I also think this idea of a political question, in the sense that somehow saying that certain questions are entirely within the domain of the political class and that the judiciary somehow cannot look into this at all. But I think it probably makes best sense to completely do away with either of these ideas. So this idea of seeing whether something is a political question or seeing whether something is basically broadly within the realm of policy, and rather merely testing whether a law, and almost anything is a law, right, when it comes from the government, whether it's in the form of a legislation or whether it's in the form of an executive order or a bylaw or a rule or a regulation or whatever it might be, or any action of the government, violates fundamental rights or not. And I think that needs to be the first and abiding sort of rule that the courts will need to look at. And on your sort of point regarding the grant of, say, a right to access to healthcare being a part of Article 21, but the courts not really doing much with it at all, I think a parallel can be drawn with the internet ban case in Kashmir. And if you look at that judgment, you see that they've almost sort of created and fashioned a new right, which is the right to access the internet under Article 21. I mean, of course, they draw sort of an illusory, I think, distinction between the right to access the internet and the right to access the internet as a medium of free speech or as a medium to do business, and they sort of link it with those two particular rights. And I think it's good that they've made that, even drawn that link. But the ultimate upshot of that being that people have a right to access the internet, whether it's a right that you want to identify with 19(1)(a) or under 21, that right exists. And then they apply sort of principles of proportionality and virtually say that yes, the government's actions are disproportional, not only for the simple reason that they were, at the first instance, they failed to disclose these orders. And as you pointed out, if you ask the government on the basis of an assertion that it's made to actually disclose the reasons for the orders that it's made, you'll find that those reasons are often absent. And in this case, they were palpably absent. I mean, there was almost no reasoning that was present in those orders to justify the ban that was imposed. But ultimately, the court sort of then virtually seems to treat it as a political question and says that there are interests of national security, interests of sovereignty at play here. And therefore, let's again put the ball back in the court of the government, but obviously now tell the government that its orders must be published. But what is the point of this publication if you're not then going to test those orders on whether it violates fundamental rights or not? And I think in the case of the internet ban, you've seen the problem already, which is that the court failed to interfere ultimately. It gave this big judgment recognizing the right to access the internet, but failed to actually hold the government accountable. But then now you again have a situation where, despite the pandemic being in force, 4G internet is not available. It's only 2G that's available through the course of the entire state. And you again have the petitioners going to the court and telling the court that these actions are disproportional. And you have the government once again regurgitating the same arguments that it made in the first instance, which the court had said are invalid at many levels. So if we really want a principled approach to this idea of judicial review and to the idea of the judiciary standing as a counter-majoritarian institution and playing what we would think is its rightful role under the constitutional structure, then we must have this idea of, as I said, ubi jus ubi remedium, where if there are rights, remedies are granted. And the court has these, has the power to grant these remedies, whether it's to issue a writ of certiorari to quash these orders that prohibit, that ban the internet, or in the case of the habeas corpus cases, in again concerning Kashmir, where, I mean, look, if you look at the writ of habeas corpus and if you go back to the roots of habeas corpus, there's almost an assumption, right? There's a prima facie presumption that any arrest is illegal. It's up to the government to show proof that the arrest is justified under law. And you had a complete reversing of the tables in these cases, where there was a presumption that these detentions made were legal. And I think that completely shifted the standard of evidence. And that's, as I see it, wholly unprincipled. But on the larger point that you make in terms of political questions and policies, I think we need to be far clearer, because, and this is not something that's just the case of the last 5 or 10 years, right? I mean, this issue of distinction between policy and principle, we've had that over the course of this entire PIL era, over the course of the last 30, 40 years. If you look, for example, in 1996 in the Delhi Science Forum judgment, you had the case where the court said that telecommunications policy is somehow outside the judicial realm because these are policy decisions. But the anti-ragging case, where the court enjoined the legislature to make laws, was not considered a matter of policy. Or Vishakha's case, where the court framed guidelines, that was not considered as a matter of policy. So where must this line really be drawn? That's something that the court needs to more carefully think about. And ultimately, we need consistency. I think judicial discretion should be consistent. If it's not consistent, then the very idea of judicial review loses significance.
So I think I'd like to make 2 points on that. One is that going to your internet ban judgment, I think another issue that's happened a lot, and I think this flows from what we're discussing, is that the actual judgments in many of these cases are written in very vague terms. So, for example, if you look at the Aadhaar judgment, Section 57 of the Aadhaar Act that allowed private parties to make use of the Aadhaar database was struck down. It was invalidated. Now, the question was on what basis had it been struck down. At one part in the majority judgment, you find the argument that this enables commercial surveillance. It is disproportionate under Article 19 and it's unconstitutional, therefore we're striking it down. At another part, you find the reasoning that what's wrong with this section is that it allows private parties to use the database through law or through contract. And the problem is that it's allowing it to happen through a contract. Right? The court doesn't specifically clarify which of these two is the actual reasoning behind holding Section 57 unconstitutional. And this really matters because if Section 57 was unconstitutional in the sense that it was a violation of fundamental rights in all cases, then the government cannot pass an ordinance to overcome that and then make it into a law later on. So what the government did, right? On the other hand, if the only shortcoming of the section was that it allowed it to happen through a contract, that can be remedied simply by a new law that specifically authorizes that. Now it's by law, right? And so this kind of obfuscation in the actual reasoning for the judgment, what this results in is that effectively both sides now have a case. The petitioners say it was struck down as unconstitutional. The government says that it was struck down because there was a bad drafting in the section, and so there was one condition was missing. But this conflict is not an equal conflict, because when the government then implements its interpretation of the judgment, right, and brings in this ordinance that it brought in to restore the old section, then the burden of taking this to court, right, and fighting the case all over again is on the petitioners. And given the first case took 6 years to resolve, I mean, that's not really a fair burden, right? And the second case has not yet been heard, by the way. The challenge to the ordinance has not yet been heard. It's still pending. It's been a while. And so effectively, these vague judgments where you declare a right, but then go round and round in circles about what you actually are holding, ultimately give the government what it wants. Because the party which has the power, right, is the party that benefits from the status quo. This is the whole point of the court not hearing cases like electoral bonds and Aadhaar for many years. It maintains the status quo that benefits one side. And similarly with these vague judgments, it keeps the status quo that's benefiting the more powerful party. And again, you can distinguish here between judgments we see today and back in the court's early days, because you may agree or disagree with those early judgments. What is clear is who won and who lost and how. Right? So if the government wins, the government wins. The matter is over. You know, the law stands and it's there. If the government loses, then the government loses. The law is gone and there's no question of wriggling or finding a way around it unless you amend the constitution, which of course happened a lot during that time. But now what we have is that even when the petitioners win, they still lose. Because what they've won is a declaration, but it's framed so vaguely that the loopholes in it swallow up the actual declaration of the right itself or the finding that the government was wrong. So I think there's something specifically that legal culture and the legal community has to insist on, that judgments have to be clear. And I'm being a little cheeky here, but my sense is that in many of these cases, the court actually understands that what the government is doing is indefensible, you know, and these sections just cannot stand scrutiny under normal constitutional review. But the court doesn't want to hand the government like a clear loss, and nor does it want to perceive as if it's endorsing in full what the government is doing. So it finds this midway point where the judgment sounds good, and you know, petitioners can say we have won and you know that we have gotten something. And that's often important, you know, in litigation strategy to say that we have gotten something. But actually, and so the courts kind of reputation as a neutral arbiter is maintained. But once you go deep into what the judgment actually says, you find that ultimately it's the state which has not really been stopped in anything. I mean, remember Manaka Gandhi didn't get her passport back, right? Like the famous case, the case that changed constitutional jurisprudence, the actual petitioner didn't really win that case. And the second point, and I'll stop here, is that I think there's also a sense of I think nihilism about the idea that the principle policy distinction is impossible to make. And therefore, you know, ultimately it's going to be a question of subjectivity. And I think, again, there the importance of legal reasoning, you know, takes center stage. And I'll give two examples from comparative law, two very interesting cases. One is a case from the Colombian Constitutional Court where a tampon tax was challenged. It was a tax that was taxed upon sanitary products, tax that, you know, like 19% or something of that kind. And again, so now tax, and Surat would know this, is supposed to be the classic, you know, policy, government policy cannot be challenged. The Colombian Constitutional Court, in a detailed, very detailed reasoned judgment, actually says that because this is a tax on an essential item that discriminatorily affects women, right? So the two things, essential for a function that you know, a bodily function, and has a discriminatory impact, and because the government has failed to demonstrate that there is a specific pressing reason for taxing sanitary products at this rate, you're striking it down, right? And again, this sounds heretical if you believe that taxes are like beyond the purview, you know, of judicial scrutiny. But you do find that you can have defensible judicial reasoning on that front. You similarly have a Canadian case called Sims versus Canada, where again, a specific tax on deductions was challenged for being discriminatory. And there again, the court actually analyzes the whole tax and says, okay, on a review of it, we find it's not discriminatory because certain facts have not been proven. But the principle that a tax, which actually is one of the fundamental governmental actions that determines human conduct, right? Like it's basically one of the most powerful tools the government has to shape conduct, that could potentially violate someone's rights, right, is something that the court, both courts, squarely confront and deal with. So they don't hide behind saying, oh, it's a policy issue, we will not go into it. Or they don't also just jump in and say, henceforth, tax cancelled and we decide what the appropriate rate is. But they actually say, okay, this is what the constitution says. This is what this tax is meant to do. Does it subscribe to constitutional standards or not? Right? And then they come out on two different ways saying yes or no. But I think it just shows you that it is possible to tackle these very difficult questions in a way that nonetheless maintains the court's role as a rights in enforcing body and not as a super government which intervenes when it wants and says hands off when it doesn't want.
I mean, for example, you might see if the government were to impose an income tax of 60% on the wealthiest tomorrow, you'll find that the courts no longer see it as a pure political question or as a question of policy. But if you go back to some of the earliest judgments of the Supreme Court, many of them are possibly indefensible in the ultimate verdict that they delivered. For example, A.K. Gopalan. But at least there was a genuine effort made at grappling with the terms of the Constitution and arriving at some sort of principled judgment, which was based on an interpretation of the text of the Constitution. Now, of course, to hold that those fundamental rights somehow belonged in separate silos was, as we know today, flawed as a matter of interpretation. But what we did get from the court was a genuine effort at engaging with the text and arriving at a judgment. Now, of course, there might be sort of contrary versions of history in terms of the political ramifications of it or in terms of the political thinking of the judges at the time and how that influenced their interpretation. But there are other judgments, of course, which are vague in terms of how they maintain the status quo. And I think I'll just end by, before we open it up for questions, in terms of the kind of impact that they've had. And the classic recent example, I think, is the order that was passed in the review petitions in the Sabarimala case, where I don't know if one can really even describe it as a judgment, but it's the sheer vagueness of it means that we have some sort of status quo that's being enforced even today, despite there being a judgment, a valid judgment of a 5-judge bench that continues in force. You don't have that judgment that is implemented on the ground. The court isn't taking cognizance of it in terms of the failure to implement the judgment being an act of contempt. We have a order of reference to 9 judges because the original judgment purportedly affects other pending cases, even though this reference could well have been made when those other cases in fact came up for hearing. And you have efforts that were made to implement the original judgment before the court, where the court simply says that let's wait for the 9-judge bench to decide and then we can thereafter take a call on this. So the utter vagueness of this means that you have a retention of the status quo, as you pointed out. And I think ultimately, as I said, just to sort of sum up our discussions in terms of what we are looking at is one, having coherent standards in terms of how the court will approach interpretation of the Constitution itself. We all know the different methods of interpretation that are available, whether you want to adopt an original intent approach or look at the living tree doctrine. And we have examples of this. If you look at the Sabarimala judgment on the original judgment on the question of Article 17 and how it has to be interpreted, you had different judges take different calls on it. You had one judge who looked at the provision in terms of its moral purport and came to a conclusion that Article 17 would include not only untouchability in terms of caste, but would include untouchability in any form as the text of the Constitution says. So that grappled with the different techniques of interpretation. So one, I think we need more coherent standards in terms of what are these techniques of interpretation that the court needs to apply or wants to apply. Second, we, I think, need to rethink, as I mentioned, this idea of the PIL somehow being a special form of litigation. It should be treated as any other form of litigation would be. Ultimately, if you look at just the Supreme Court is there under, when it exercises its jurisdiction under Article 32, it exists to enforce fundamental rights. So PILs need to be restricted to the enforcement of fundamental rights. You can't have orders such as the National Anthem Order that was originally passed, for example, where you have the complete converse, where fundamental rights are in fact infringed by judgments of the court. So I think PILs need to be treated as any other form of litigation. The court should apply rigorous standards with respect to standing and locus standi. And those standings, you should, I think, have... I, I, whatever that rule has to be, whether it's sufficient interest as is followed in the UK or whatever other rules might be followed in other jurisdictions, whatever rule that our courts might want to follow, there needs to be a clear standard that is devised. And if that sufficient interest is not met, you might still exercise a public interest litigation jurisdiction by saying that those persons, and this is the original formulation of PILs, right? And I think one can't really have too many qualms over how PILs were originally conceived, because there was a genuine case of people not being able to approach the courts, prisoners not being able to approach the courts, letters written by prisoners to the Supreme Court. I don't think we can sit here and say that the court should not have interfered in those cases. That can't be the solution. But at the same time, the solution can't be to loosen standards to such an extent where somebody who's completely unrelated to the case or has no sort of even has shown no consistent sort of, you know, perhaps interest in these kind of matters. You don't want a random individual approaching the court trying to say that they're concerned about bonded labor in some other state, perhaps even in a state that they're not even living in. So they need to show that sufficient interest in the matter, even if they're not personally, I think, affected by it. So those standards need to be devised. I think one other area where the courts need to really devise principles is when the Supreme Court is treated as a court of first instance and when you approach the high courts. And there's absolutely no clarity on this. So for example, on the challenges to the Central Vista project, you had people approaching the Delhi High Court first and the Supreme Court thereafter transferred it to itself. And then ultimately in the order that it passes, in the interim order that it passes, it says that this is not a matter of urgency. Nothing is going to happen during the pandemic. Let's wait and see. Then why transfer it to yourself in the first place? So I think there needs to be clearer principles that are devised in terms of when the Supreme Court interferes in Article 32 as a court of first instance and when it takes cases before itself from the high courts. And even with respect to other matters, I mean, even if you look at the, for example, the Arnab Goswami case, the recent case where the court interfered, there was no attempt made to approach the high courts in the first place. In almost every other case where personal liberty is threatened, the courts might say, why don't you go to the high courts first? Or I understand that there were numerous FIRs possibly filed in different states. But even then, you might have to first show that you approach the high courts and thereafter the Supreme Court transferred the case to it. So I'm just using this as an example. I'm not saying that the court was necessarily wrong in the ultimate order that was passed. But there needs to be principles in terms of when the court interferes as a court of first instance and when it doesn't. And I think there's a complete lack of consistency on that. And finally, on evidentiary standards, in terms of fact finding and in terms of what role the court plays as an adversarial body, because ultimately the court is in India, the system of justice is an adversarial system of justice and courts are there to decide disputed questions of fact. So the Supreme Court itself has made this distinction between jurisdictional and administrative facts in the past, but I don't think it seems to apply that to its own judgments or hold the high courts accountable in terms of that application of that distinction between jurisdictional and administrative facts. The court has held previously that when a jurisdictional fact is at stake, it can enter into this realm of deciding on those disputed questions, but it doesn't seem to apply those principles. And it, as you said, follows a system of convenience. And that is where I think we ultimately need to see change. And this is, of course, without considering, as I mentioned right at the outset, all the various other institutional changes that I think we need to see in the court. And we could also say that without those institutional changes happening, we're probably not going to see these changes in principle. Right. So, Anant?
Yeah. Thank you.
If you have anything else to add, we can go over to questions.
Yeah, sure. So thank you both. I mean, this has been a very comprehensive discussion, and I would add quite lucid in the way that you have explained the current lapses or gaps in the way the court is functioning. So we have actually quite a few questions here. I will handpick a few. So I'll begin with a question posed by Srinivasan M, who wants to know your thoughts on, both of you, in fact, your thoughts on the seal cover jurisprudence, which has been developed by the Supreme Court. Gautam, would
I
mean, you like
my to thoughts are in one sentence, completely indefensible. I mean, there's nothing more that I have to say on that. It's just ridiculous.
Right. I mean, in the NRC case, for example, you had an instance of the court not even giving the Attorney General some of this information. So it is utterly indefensible. It's completely antithetical to the ideas of transparency. Courts are meant to be transparent. Evidence is supposed to be supplied to both parties. Parties should be in a position to respond to the evidence that the court is considering. And I don't think there can be two answers to this at all.
I mean, the Delhi High Court in the UAPA case banned an organization on the basis, on the specific basis of material in a sealed cover, which the organization's lawyer wasn't allowed to see. Like, you're basically banning this group, affecting their fundamental rights under Article 19, and their lawyer doesn't get the evidence on the basis of which you, the judge, has upheld the ban. This is kangaroo court level. I mean, this is not a court. Like, this is just like, this is exactly what you get in show trials, all that you read about in like Stalinist countries where you have these show trials with, you know, cases decided pre. I mean, this is exactly that. Like, material which the lawyer defending the guy can't see, and you ban the guy.
Right. So the next question is Darshan Kabra. What is the role of the judiciary in deciding questions of conflict of interest where a judge has previously passed the judgment in a challenge to the same issue previously? It's evident what we are talking about here, sir.
Yeah, I mean, I think if I can just... Gautam, do you want me to go first? Or?
You go first, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's not as simple and straightforward to sort of deal with this because you have a number of instances where judges have decided on certain principles or certain issues where they're again sitting on judgments over similar issues, whether they were when they're part of a larger bench, etc. But I think in this specific case with respect to the land acquisition statute and the interpretation of Section 24, you had a case where a particular judge sitting first as a two-judge bench had found the judgment of another, of a previous three-judge bench, which had been followed, I think, by nearly 200 other Supreme Court judgments and 1,000 High Court judgments as research by CPR found. You had a two-judge bench virtually questioning the judgment of a three-judge bench without making a reference to a larger bench. And indeed, a two-judge bench could not have even made such a reference. I think if you have a binding three-judge bench decision, you're bound to follow it. And that's the sort of foundational basis of principles of stare decisis, which are applicable to the Supreme Court. And then you had the same judge sitting then as a three-judge bench. Again, once again, not making a reference to a larger bench, but merely holding the prior three-judge bench judgment to be per incurium, that is, to have been delivered in ignorance of law. Then what happened was you had a different three-judge bench differ with this new three-judge bench judgment and say that they were following the original judgment. And ultimately, you had a reference made to a constitution bench. And when that reference was made, you had the Chief Justice of India constituting this bench in such a manner that very judge who had made the reference was once again placed as the presiding judge to hear the reference. And I think this is a case of res ipsa loquitur, as we say, right? This, the thing speaks for itself. This is a classic case of a conflict of interest in many ways. This is not a conflict of interest in its conventional sense of there being some pecuniary bias, etc. But this was a case where you had a judge having taken such a firm view opposed to every judgment that has been delivered by the Supreme Court, thereafter decide the reference. And I think when an application for recusal was made, the learned judge ought to have ordered the application. But it's also important to point out that there were four other judges on that bench who decided to go with him in terms of this, saying that the recusal was not mandated in that case. So I think it's a blot. I mean, it's a serious blot on the Supreme Court.
Yeah, no, I'll say two things. I mean, I'm always hesitant now to talk about this case because the judge in question is already accused legal writers of trying to influence the court writing about this case, you know, in open court long, and there were other judges on the bench who didn't say a word about that. So it does feel that talking about this case will open you up to accusations of being part of a lobby influencing the court. But that apart, two things. One is that, as Surit said, this is not one of those cases where, okay, so I'm sitting as a judge adjudicating upon a case. I see precedent come before me and there seems to be something wrong with the precedent. I think that, you know, either times have changed or there's a legal mistake somewhere over there. So I form a prima facie view and I refer the case to a larger bench, right? It's often happened that in a case like that, the referring judge then sits on the higher bench because that judge is supposed to have formed, you know, kind of had experience with that case. But the basis of that is that judge only that judge was ruling upon a case. In the course of that, this precedent was standing in his or her way, and he or she thinks that this may need reconsideration, right? So it's not that. That judge is still to hear arguments, comprehensive arguments on both sides on the correctness of that case. So he or she is not yet supposed to have formed a complete view. What happened in this case, right, was that this judge sits as a bench of three, right? So 248-page, I think that was the length. That judgment says not only that this other judgment is wrong, but it's per incurium, which means that like it was so wrong that it's not law at all. That's the level of certainty he has in his view. And then he's presiding over, you know, the larger bench. And I think that's completely ridiculous. As I said before, it's basically, it's like you have an answer script. You send it to examiner A and examiner B. Examiner B fails, examiner A passes the student. And to break the tie, you send it back to examiner A to remark, or maybe he might change his mind. That's obviously not how it works, right? That's one. And secondly, I think this is really important. You can't understand this without understanding that the Indian Supreme Court is not a normal constitutional court in the sense that it doesn't sit on bank, right? So if the court sat on bank, or even if like the UK, right, where you have like benches of 5 out of 15, right, where a significant number of the judges in the court sit on all cases, right? In that kind of case, the court changing its mind, altering its views, you know, all of that is one thing, because the court is speaking as one, right? Like it's the court institutionally speaking as in one voice. When you have 34 judges, right, who sit in benches of 2 and 3, and you have one set of 3 judges who have ruled one way and another set who have ruled the other way, effectively what you have is within the same court, two groups of judges who have 2 different views on interpretation, right? And then you can't use your normal standards of bias in that kind of a case, because the structure of your court isn't the structure under which the old bias rules were evolved. They were always evolved with a view to thinking of the court speaking in one voice. And that's where I think you need to think of something like the ECHR format, where you have an appeals chamber, or like a grand chamber, and like a normal ECHR chamber. And if a case goes from the ECHR normal chamber to the grand chamber, then the same judges can't sit, right? So in that sense, if you have a clash of interpretation between 2 sets of judges in the same court, and you have to resolve that clash, right? Then it shouldn't go to one of them, because then what you effectively have is factions, right? You have factions in the court, and then you're giving the Chief Justice effectively, one individual, the power to decide which faction kind of comes out on top. So I think that this whole issue of bias conflict needs to be re-looked at, because the court that we are engaging with is a polyvocal court with multiple judges, multiple points of view. And so then you have to think of bias in that context. You can't think of bias in the same way that the English common law evolved the idea in a very different, you know, institutional background.
I do want to add that this, the one other issue that we must sort of bear in mind here is the question of, again, of master rule roster. I mean, why did the Chief Justice of India choose this particular judge to again preside over this constitution bench? And we shouldn't sort of lose track of that as well, because I think we ultimately also need to democratize the role of the Chief Justice of India. I mean, the CJI is obviously an administrative head of the court, but in terms of the master of the roster, I don't know what precisely needs to be the format that is followed, but you can't have the court essentially being beholden to one individual. This needs to change. You can't have the entire shape of the court, the entire jurisprudential development of the court being dependent on one particular individual. This is way too much power in the hands of one person, and that cannot be good for judicial review. That can't be good for democracy.
Rachita Chawla has a very interesting question. She asks, at times when courts reach a progressive standpoint, the reasons for approaching the same could be problematic. For example, calling women the honor of the family and the victimization of the family rather than individuality of the person involved. So is it time for more gender sensitization at the highest levels?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you have a case, I think, where the Supreme Court, in terms of the manner in which it handled this entire controversy over the former Chief Justice of India, who was accused of sexual harassment, I mean, that would show that the court, that there is a genuine need for not just sensitivization, but in terms of reshaping how the court thinks about these issues. So, therefore, I completely agree with her in terms of there being.
I think it's an important point, and I think you've seen it often that judgments that reach what are, you think, the correct conclusions reached them because of you know, paternalistic reasoning or you know, what I think what the Kerala High Court called romantic paternalism in many of the gender equality judgments, for example. So yeah, no, I think that it's really important to focus on the reasoning as strongly as on the conclusion. And you had you actually have some, I think, interesting progress in that, at least in the domain of gender. There were some very good Delhi High Court judgments by Justice Bhatt back when he was in the Delhi High Court on the issue of pregnancy discrimination that really focused on indirect discrimination as a concept. I think it's important to again as a question of legal culture and legal community to really take these judgments and you know, talk about them, write about them, and you know, explain or discuss why the reasoning that they employ is particularly important to get to what otherwise everyone agrees is the correct conclusion.
And I think this is also sort of part of the, I mean, this is not essentially related to the manner in which the court came to the conclusion, but the Sabarimala judgment as well. Mm-hmm. If you look at 3 out of the 5 judges, they applied, I mean, in fact, 4 out of the 5 judges applied the essential religious practices test, and there are serious problems, I think, with the doctrine. Although that is sort of the doctrine that they ought to apply in terms of by applying principles of stare decisis. But we can see that this is not possibly the right way to decide a dispute where a claim is made under Articles 25 and 26. So in this case, you had one judge who was part of the majority as arbiter pointing out that there are serious problems with the doctrine. And I think that was one good way to go about it. But it's also important for people who are commenting about these judgments to not merely commend the case for the ultimate verdict that it reached, which you might well agree with, but also sort of scrutinize how they arrived at that judgment in terms of whether the application of this doctrine was the right way to ultimately come to a conclusion that the prohibition of women from entering the temple is constitutionally justified or not. And one other point that I would like to make on the Sabarimala judgment is that the other thing that you might want to engage with is, did the court have to go that far in order to arrive at the final judgment? For example, this was a case where the rule could quite easily have been struck down as being ultra vires the act, and the matter would have ended there. Did it have to go into pages and pages of enunciation on constitutional morality, on issues of essential religious practice, etc.? It might not have had to do so had it merely held the rule to be ultra vires the act, which it quite easily could have done on a simple interpretation of the rule and the statute.
I have one final question to both of you before we wind up this conversation. This is regarding the point that Gautam had raised on the difference between how the Kenyan court looked at the biometric system and how we had dealt with it. So that's at one level, you know, a difficulty in terms of how we have developed our thought on you know, raising questions of fact at the appellate level. Similarly, is there a gap that you see at the substantive level itself, right? For instance, one of the things that kept coming up, you know, in the Aadhaar challenge was the fact that European courts had developed much more sophisticated and more holistic tests to understand what a technology system can do to privacy baseline, right? And the Supreme Court had two different answers. One was the policy principle distinction, especially when it comes to looking at regulatory, you know, safeguards like the UIDA and all of that. And the second was to really basically say that the possibility of abuse is not a ground really to strike things down, right? But today, when we look at the COVID situation, right, we are now deploying a lot more of these kinds of solutions. And at some level, a rollback on privacy might be here to stay, unless we have a more vibrant test coming from the Supreme Court. So we'd really like to hear your thoughts on how we could tackle this at a substantive level, beyond, of course, you know, better ways of examining questions of fact and so on.
You want to go first?
No, you can go. Yeah.
I'm not quite sure actually, because there is a general problem with I think the reasoning that you see in many judgments. I have found though that at least when the court sits as a constitution bench, in the last, you know, 4 or 5 years, I have disagreed very strongly with many of the reasons it's given in constitution bench decisions. But I've still found, I mean, there to have been substantial thought on the questions and you know, reasoning given and a conclusion. Now, I think Aadhaar is an exception. I mean, there were many, many issues with the reasoning there. But otherwise, in constitution bench judgments, both with the ones I've agreed with and the ones I've disagreed with, I think there's been reasoning there. There's been good judicial reasoning that is there. I think it's because, I mean, when the court sits as a CB, it's kind of giving that matter some thought. Whereas when it sits in two or three judge benches, it's like kind of run of the mill routine everyday cases. Specifically on the question of privacy, Aadhaar, surveillance, and so on. So I think there are two things. I think one is that the test that the court evolved in Tottaswamy and then applied in Aadhaar, the test itself is pretty much the global standard now. Proportionality, the four-step test, the least restrictive alternative has to be applied, and so on. So as far as the doctrine goes, we are pretty much there with everybody else. I mean, it's the same. Pretty much all over the world, we follow the same doctrine. I think the question is an application where, so for example, in the Aadhaar case, there was a question of whether, the centralized biometric ID was the least restrictive form of that this could take. And the petitioners argued that, no, you have other less restrictive forms like smart cards. And the court basically didn't engage with that. Like, it just ignored that argument altogether and said that there have been no suggestions made on alternatives. So I think the first thing is to really focus, again, as a legal community, as a legal culture, as legal writers, to point out that, look, you have this doctrine. Now, please apply it the way it should be, and to hold the court to account for that in public forums. That's one thing. I think secondly, I think this is a much deeper and larger question. It still seems to me that what Kanabiran used to say, that in the Indian constitution, the restrictions have become fundamental and the rights are the ones that are reasonable rights that can be given when reasonable. That's a cultural, legal culture issue that I think requires to be tackled. Because at least for me, whenever I have been in these cases in court, standing behind standing on the side watching the seniors argue the cases, what I've always found is that there is a very, very high threshold that you have to cross just to persuade the court that that this is a serious case. This is not some random publicity-seeking person who's arrived screaming privacy, there's just a fundamental level of skepticism that the judiciary has when it comes to rights-based challenges to projects that are defended as being about the larger public good and in the public welfare. So that inherent skepticism, I think that, and there's a limit, and there's a linked point to that, which is that we still have a legal culture where there's a lot of this whole PIL idea of the court and the government collaborating and working together to find solutions. That idea is still very, very strong. And you saw it when the Chief Justice, ex-Chief Justice, said that his job is to be a bridge between the parliament and the judiciary. So the role of the court as being inherently skeptical about the government's claims and being, and maintaining a distance and maintaining a kind of suspicion, healthy suspicion, about the government's claims when it comes to this balance between rights and welfare. I think that we have to get that back as a fundamental part of our legal culture. And again, that's, I think, a broader question of talking about these things, discussing them, writing about them, and just going back to first principles and saying, look, wherever there is a center of power, organized power, institutional power, right, our job is to question and interrogate that power and to be skeptical about it. Right? And we may find at the end it's fine, but our starting point has to be that way we question what the power is doing and force it to account for itself in the public forum.
Okay. I'll just be brief. I mean, I don't have too much to add to that. And I think part of this problem has arisen out of the Supreme Court becoming this sort of good governance court, right? In the sense of it not really bothering with reasoning, almost sort of stepping into the shoes of the executive and the legislature. Once it started to do that, I think it almost started to see itself as an extension of the other wings of government, as opposed to being a standalone body, which was there to check those actions of the executive and the legislature. So once it starts thinking like government, then the moment government says, comes before court and says that this is needed in the larger public interest, then the court sort of almost naturally tends to lean towards the government. Now, of course, we have this sort of larger principle of presumption of constitutionality, etc. And I think at some levels, those presumptions might need to be rethought of. I'm not saying that we need to look at every action of the government as prima facie unconstitutional. That's not my suggestion. But where must that presumption really be applicable? Now, we've already had some judgments where the court has said that this presumption is not applicable to pre-constitutional statutes, that is, statutes that were enacted before the constitution came into force. But now, for example, as I was mentioning with respect to the habeas corpus cases, there is a presumption that every arrest or every order of detention is invalid. It's up to the government to, come before court and establish, and the burden is then is on the government. The onus shifts to the government. So I think that we already have these evolved standards of proportionality. We have this sort of four-prong test, and the court really needs to start engaging with each of those prongs. I mean, first, look at whether there is a law. Second, whether look at the necessity. I mean, and this would sort of link to my larger point in terms of evidentiary standards and what are the manners in which fact determinations need to happen. Because when you have these claims of necessity, or when you're saying that a particular technological project is not really necessary, or it doesn't actually achieve the purposes for which it has been devised, then you'll necessarily have to enter a situation where the court will have to look into those disputed questions of fact. So if it wants to really apply with rigor these principles that it has evolved, then it needs to also start thinking more clearly in terms of evidentiary standards and really sort of refashion itself in terms of what kind of body it needs to be under our constitutional structure.
Thank you both. I mean, this has been a fascinating conversation ranging on a wide range of issues, from transparency of the court's functioning to the way it sees and perceives itself, and of course shaping a better legal principles to bring about more consistency and certainty in its operations and to be a more accountable court overall. Thank you both. And for all of you here, would request you to take a look at the Daksha Fellowship. We are at www.dakshafellowship.org, and we are happy to help you with any queries on the fellowship. Feel free to also reach out to us at 99400-57400. If I may repeat, 99400-57400. We look forward to having your applications in very soon. And of course, these conversations on the way the legal system operates and our institutions, which are meant to protect rights and to safeguard citizen interests, will continue, and keep following our work on social media handles and so on. Thanks once again to Suhrit and Gautam for having taken out a Sunday evening/afternoon for this conversation. Look forward to having you more engaged with our students once they begin the fellowship in August. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.